The NSA, or National Security Agency, is a government agency with the current stated purpose of protecting American citizens from terrorist threats. Since the Obama administration took power, though, the word terrorist has been applied very broadly. Now, a terrorist can range from a Taliban insurgent to a peaceful protester or environmental rights activist engaging in peaceful dissent. The NSA headquarters is located in Washington, D.C. It is on what is known as the black budget, meaning its annual budget is classified, although the last known annual budget was $1.8 billion. The NSA protects Americans from these threats, some legitimate and others not, by massive data collection of all internet and phone records from every American citizen, and even citizens and leaders from around the world. Earlier this year, a contractor of the NSA, Edward Snowden, released the classified information that the NSA was doing this data collection. This was news to most Americans and citizens of the countries being spied on, but most shocked were the world leaders whose phones had been tapped and computers accessed by the NSA. These leaders included U.S. allies such as France and Germany. The list continues, including Russia, Mexico, Brazil, and 30 other countries around the world. This revelation left Snowden stranded in China until he left for Russia, from where he continues to leak documents, through Glenn Greenwald, a journalist at the British newspaper, The Guardian. This revelation has serious repercussions for the alliances the U.S. has with other countries, but also for U.S. citizens. This massive data collection not only creates more of an Orwellian society, but also poses a huge security risk for the Americans who now can have their data accessed by the thousands of employees that work for the National Security Agency. The data collection done by the NSA turns the free-thinking democracy we strive for into a police state reminiscent of 1984.
Talk a little bit about how the American surveillance state actually functions. Does it target the actions of Americans?
NSA and the intelligence community in general is focused on getting intelligence wherever it can, by any means possible, that it believes on the grounds of sort of a self-certification that they serve the national interest. Originally, we saw that focus very narrowly tailored as foreign intelligence gathered overseas. Now, increasingly, we see that it's happening domestically. And to do that, the NSA specifically, targets the communications of everyone. It ingests them by default. It collects them in its system, and it filters them, and it analyzes them, and it measures them, and it stores them for periods of time, simply because that's the easiest, most efficient, and most valuable way to achieve these ends. So while they may be intending to target someone associated with a foreign government or someone that they suspect of terrorism, they're collecting your communications to do so. Any analyst at any time can target anyone, any selector anywhere. Where those communications will be picked up depends on the range of the sensor networks and the authorities that that analyst is empowered with. Not all analysts have the ability to target everything, but I, sitting at my desk, certainly have the authorities to wiretap anyone, from you or your accountant to a federal judge to even the president if I had a personal email.
So the NSA was created in the United States after World War II. And their charge is basically to advise the president on national security matters. Prior to World War II, there was no agency that was similar that had either this kind of job or this kind of authority. The unusual thing about the NSA is that it doesn't have the kind of legislative oversight that other branches of government do, like the FBI. They're just kind of like super police, and they're subject to the same rules and restrictions as other kinds of police. But the NSA, because they operate in this atmosphere of secrecy for the purpose of protecting us from secret threats, they've got a lot more leeway. There's not quite as many people looking over their shoulder.
The NSA is a government organization. The NSA stands for National Security Agency. Its purpose is to monitor the United States and for purposes of national security.
It's a big program that's spying on each and every citizen. You have a tab, they have a tab for you, they just click it and then they know everything that you've been doing through the internet, communications, all of that.
They're looking over our internet and everything that we do online and our computers.
National Security Agency, is that correct, I believe? And they pretty much handle all the, as far as I know, surveillance and national security matters.
My name's Ed Snowden. I'm 29 years old. I work for Booz Allen Hamilton as an infrastructure analyst for NSA in Hawaii. I've been a systems engineer, systems administrator, senior advisor for the Central Intelligence Agency, solutions consultant, and a telecommunications information systems officer.
Tonight, we focus on the leaker. His name is Edward Snowden, and he's an employee of defense contractor Booz Allen Hamilton, named, of course, after our drunkest founding father.
In terms of recent incidents, a contractor at the NSA decided that it was his patriotic duty to expose to the people, to the press, and to the Congress exactly what the NSA is, or some of what the NSA has been up to, say, for the last 10 years. So he stole a huge pile of documents, but then shared these documents about secret NSA surveillance activities with the press. So what he said all along, his name's Edward Snowden, is that his purpose was to tell everybody about this. He wasn't trying to get rich off of it. He wasn't trying to sell secrets or even tell America's enemies anything that would help them to defeat the United States. He was instead trying to free information where it would do the most good. He thinks of himself as a patriot.
He was a guy who worked for the NSA, and then he revealed a number of classified documents about what the NSA was doing.
Well, who is he? He's a lower level person who is working on a contract. My understanding also that Snowden was actually a relatively low level contractor. He was just an employee working for some small company that was had a contract with NSA, but he had access to quite a lot of sensitive information. Not somebody that was particularly a leader in any way. He was just a worker. He was involved in, at some level of that operation, and he felt it was wrong and made that public, and he had proof. So he made it public that the government has been engaged in spying on U.S. citizens, and actually citizens from around the world, and governments from around the world.
Have you given thought to what it is that the U.S. government's response to your conduct is in terms of what they might say about you, how they might try to depict you, what they might try to do to you?
Yeah, I could be, you know, rendered by the CIA. I could have people come after me or any of their third-party partners. They work closely with a number of other nations. Or, you know, they could pay off the triads or, you know, any of their agents or assets. We've got a CIA station just up the road in the consulate here in Hong Kong, and I'm sure they're going to be very busy for the next week. And that's a fear I'll live under for the rest of my life, however long that happens to be. You can't come forward against the world's most powerful intelligence agencies and be completely free from risk, because they're such powerful adversaries that no one can meaningfully oppose them. If they want to get you, they'll get you in time. But at the same time, you have to make a determination about what it is that's important to you. And if living unfreely but comfortably is something you're willing to accept, and I think many of us are, it's the human nature. You can get up every day, you can go to work, you can collect your large paycheck for relatively little work. Against the public interest and go to sleep at night after watching your shows. But if you realize that that's the world that you helped create, and it's going to get worse with the next generation and the next generation who extend the capabilities of this sort of architecture of oppression, you realize that you might be willing to accept any risk, and it doesn't matter what the outcome is, so long as the public gets to make their own decisions about how that's applied.
Yeah, I wouldn't call him a traitor, no. More like a hero to me, yeah.
Yeah, I feel like he works for the people and the government doesn't. Basically, he's a hero for the people and a traitor for the government, because as of right now, well, I think in 2013, we have a government that works for the people, but we have a government that works more for the president than the people in charge instead of the people. So I feel like people don't really have enough power to say anything. That's why they don't really care about what NSA does, is, you know, you can't really do anything about it.
Well, you know, I think this is one of those questions where it isn't black and white. You know, you're neither hero nor traitor with no choices in between. You know, he's a bit of a traitorous guy. The general claim that if terrorists knew how much we were using surveillance on the internet or cell phones, that they wouldn't share information or use cell phones or the internet, I find pretty implausible. I mean, I can't believe that there's terrorists out there going, oh, it's the internet, so I don't think there's any surveillance here. I imagine that they have a fairly accurate grasp on how vulnerable or not vulnerable internet communications are to being listened to. It doesn't seem like a really credible claim to me. So that idea that all of a sudden terrorists are gonna be quiet now because Edward Snowden has told them that people are listening doesn't really sound that likely. He certainly, at least is what Congress is saying today, is if he really wanted Congress to know about it, he should have told Congress. You know, I think it's a case to be made that if he did that, they would have just buried it.
Indifferently.
Yeah, indifferently.
I feel that he's not a hero for exposing these things, but I also don't see him as a traitor because many of these facts were needed to be known by people, and that makes them more aware of what's going on in their own country, which is a really necessary thing in maintaining a good people-to-government relationship.
Well, it's a combination of things, really. I mean, on the one hand, he did leak quite a lot of security that could be potentially dangerous to people in our country. The people that are being watched know they're being watched, then they can more easily evade detection. On the other hand, I think the nature and extent of the information that they're taking on people were generally not appreciated or written off as a conspiracy theory. If you said, oh, they're watching everything we do, people would say, oh, right, conspiracy theory, you know. Where's your foil? You got to make a hat out of foil, right? And it turns out that people who were that suspicious of the government seem to be proven right.
I'm half and half on his actions. I do believe what he did was a great gesture for everybody in order to bring forth truth that the government was keeping from us on what they've been doing. But I also believe that in going against his country, he shouldn't have done it. But I do believe that it was for the best. I'm not sure if I would be able to pick, but I do see him as a general hero of the public.
Well, I see him as a whistleblower. And I think he should be protected in that way. I see him as a hero, actually, because I think he is trying to preserve the democracy that we wish for. We have an illusion that we're in a democratic environment, and we are in a partially democratic environment, but with operations like this, it means that we're not informed. We don't know what's going on with the government, and we can't hold it accountable. And it is actually, in my opinion, a violation of the Constitution, which guarantees privacy. I think he's done a big service to all of us in the United States and around the world.
There came some point in time when you crossed this line of thinking about being a whistleblower to making the choice to actually become a whistleblower. Walk people through that decision-making process.
When you're in positions of privileged access, like a systems administrator for these sort of intelligence community agencies, you're exposed to a lot more information on a broader scale than the average employee. And because of that, you see things that may be disturbing, but over the course of a normal person's career, you'd only see one or two of these instances. When you see everything, you see them on a more frequent basis. And you recognize that some of these things are actually abuses. People tend not to take them very seriously and, you know, move on from them. But over time, that awareness of wrongdoing sort of builds up and you feel compelled to talk about it. And the more you talk about it, the more you're ignored, the more you're told it's not a problem. Until eventually you realize that these things need to be determined by the public, not by somebody who was simply hired by the government.
So what I wanted to see is if you could give me a yes or no answer to the question, does the NSA collect any type of data at all on millions or hundreds of millions of Americans?
No, sir.
It does not.
Not wittingly. There are cases where they could inadvertently, perhaps, collect, but not wittingly.
I think that it all should have a warrant if you want to grab that information. You need a warrant to do so.
Yeah, I mean, NSA had power over, you know, the Boston Bombers, Facebook. So they probably had their YouTube account. They had their messaging. If they could, they couldn't really do anything about it. The bombing still happened. So, like, until I don't get proof that NSA is really helping us and they're, you know, saving lives every day, I don't see why they need to tap wire into my phone, because let's say a terrorist was trying to do something bad, they'd know NSA is on your phone. Like, let's say I want to text him about something we're going to do that's illegal. It's not like I'm going to call him up and say, you know, talk to him. Because I know, you know, NSA is all over the internet and the news. So I know that NSA is watching me. So if I don't want to talk to him, I just go get a prepaid phone and not ever get tracked. So I feel like NSA doesn't really do what they're supposed to, except for like people's private information.
They said it was helping, but I've never like actually seen the legit like things they were doing. You know, like I've never seen any faces to those terrorists. I just heard words. So I mean, I guess they're doing something, but I haven't seen much improvement. Yeah. Seems all talk.
Yeah, they probably are catching some people, but it's really worth all our privacy. It's like, okay, I get you're gonna stop a criminal or two, but at the same time, you're just taking everyone else's life away, so.
I think it's a complete invasion of privacy. I mean, there are some things on the internet like that aren't private. Like, I mean, Facebook isn't really that private. Text messages, though, that's like totally private. I feel like it should be, at least. Obviously, it's not. I feel like it should be, though.
I'm personally fine with that.
You know, overall, the public response has been shockingly, like, people just don't seem to care very much. They don't seem to have very high expectations of privacy. So I guess I kind of feel the same way. I'm not maybe as shocked as I should be. And I've always sort of considered using a cell phone kind of the equivalent of shouting out the window. At the same time, that doesn't, I mean, I'm not comfortable with unsupervised surveillance power.
I would say no, because the things that I do that, you know, I don't do things on the web that I'm ashamed of. So personally, you know, I don't have Facebook. You know, I don't do things where I might be kind of drawn into making comments. I don't do social media. So it's not like I was drawn into doing something and I've had to scale back and say, whoa, I'm scared now. And to be honest, although I've understood this in kind of a mental way, the security issues, I still have a whole online presence. You know, all of my bank accounts, I've got electronic statements. I don't get paper statements anymore from my bank. And I haven't changed that. I haven't gone back to paper yet. I haven't really processed enough whether I need to or not. So I would say no, I haven't really changed what I do.
You know, I think it hasn't physically changed it, but I would now think twice about communicating with some people that I know. Yeah, I would think twice about some of the communications that I have, you know.
I feel like maybe if I would like think about it that much, maybe I'd censor things more, but I don't really think about the NSA thing, so no, not really.
No, it doesn't, because even though you can talk to your friends about, you know, let's say something that's illegal in a way, I don't think the government has enough time to go and punish the teenagers that, you know, do minor stuff. But again, I don't feel like anyone on a big scale crime talks through any of the sources that NSA has access to.
Greatly, yes. I'm often very cautious of what I write now on emails. and on social media. And mainly if I'm communicating with people online, I would stick to mostly video services such as Skype as just simply a way of keeping an unrecorded log of what, you know, me and my friends talk about. Of course, it's nothing illegal, but the virtue still applies.
Oh, 1984. Okay, yeah. Well, no, it is definitely not anything like 1984 or the big whole Big Brother society.
1984 comes to mind, of course, Big Brother. And in the year 1984, very much of America's popular media had stories like, hey, everybody, it's 1984. Guess what? The book didn't come true. And in fact, the book was coming true. And the fact that they thought it wasn't coming true just shows how true it really was, because they were being watched, they were being monitored, they were being manipulated, and they didn't know it. Or at least they were leading the American public. They were trying to get the American public not to know it. So I think you want to pick a landmark in literature, that's got to be at 1984. And it came true. Now, not in every detail, of course, but the overall surveillance and control and manipulation of people by propaganda society is true today.
1984, a great piece of literature that portrayed a state, a surveillance state, and what life would be like.
I believe his name is George Orwell, or a couple of his books did have some similar correlation to the NSA.
1984. I believe from that book we got a word with his name, Orwellian. That could be one way of describing all this, kind of an Orwellian ordeal, but that novel definitely has some strong connections to this with kind of like thought police, really. They aren't directly taking control, but they're monitoring what we're saying, what we're thinking.
Probably not. I'm skeptical. I think what protects us as citizens of a democracy is we need some checks and balances built into the system so that people with expertise in terrorism are checking and balancing people making claims about what's necessary. You don't just hand over all the power to one group and let them decide what's necessary. There should be a constant evaluation, a skeptical eye, and some power reserved to people who could actually stop the NSA if they did go too far.
It seems to me that it's a government program that's really out of control. I think that there's no question that hoovering up all the possible information, Hoover, like J. Edgar Hoover, that's a good pun. Just taking all that information is more risky to individuals than not having it. But it's not easy for me to say, okay, what is the right amount of surveillance that there should be? Again, if people are plotting some kind of a terrorist activity, what's going to stop them? Okay, we don't know. Now, you could say, what if the United States had a foreign policy that wasn't creating enemies in these countries? I think that there might be deeper solutions that cause us to rethink the way we act in the world, whom we support, and how we support them in the world. And so there might be ultimately other ways to be safer as citizens and as a country. The families of the people are not going to be very happy with us anytime soon. I feel like we're doing a very good job recruiting more terrorists with some of our foreign actions. And so I don't know what's the right level. You know, I can say that it bothers me, I think it's wrong, and I think it's really, really dangerous to have this level of surveillance. But I can't give you an expert answer about what's the right level of surveillance. Because I think having none doesn't seem realistic either.
I think that it damages freedom overall. And if you're talking security, then you have to decide that then it becomes a trade-off, and you can live in a surveillance state and you might be more secure, but you won't have the kind of life that you want to have. If you want to live in a creative, creative environment where people are flourishing and learning new things and trying new things and holding each other accountable, this is a big, big deal. And having a government that is working for you, that you can hold accountable. We're supposed to be, we select our government, and we are supposed to hold it accountable. And we can't if we don't, if we're being spied on by the very entity that we're responsible for holding accountable.
I think the common response is, well, if I don't do anything wrong, I'm okay. So if I don't buy online porn, you know, nobody can come after me for that. But I think that's actually missing the point. I think for one thing, the information that they're gathering isn't all that secure. So if some lower level IT guy in his 20s can escape with hard disks full of information, then I think it's likely that any other person who somehow got a security clearance but might be a short-term contract employee could. And when it's not just the things that they might shame you with on the internet, your bank account information, if you do any online banking, I think if you or your parents have investments with Fidelity or Vanguard or a broker or anything like that, all of that is out there. And if you've ever bought anything at Amazon, if you've ever bought anything at iTunes, those are all out there. And there are people walking around with access to all that information. So it's really a huge lack of security in what most people assume is a secure financial system. I mean, they could bring the world to its knees. The second thing I think that most people don't really appreciate is the political ramifications of this. It may be that you yourself haven't done anything to be ashamed of, but what about that congressman? What about that district attorney or that the public prosecutor who's investigating, oh, I don't know, say bank fraud, but that person has used their cell phone to contact prostitutes or something like that. That person could be blackmailed with that information. And again, your passwords, it doesn't matter if you think your line is encrypted, they've already forced the major companies to put security gaps into their products so that they can get all that information. So I think that the question of who has the data, how secure is it, and what it's being used for is extremely troubling.
If we're talking about our freedom, I think it's damaging because it makes us less strong as a country. I know it does. It stifles debate, it stifles information and education, and it's going to ultimately dumb down what we get to know and what's presented to us. It's already having an effect, and people are going to shut up, and then we're not going to learn much from each other. And it allows the people with the information to have a lot more power over the people without and people who do not have the information, whether they are people in the government or whether they're people in corporations who own this power. It's a huge, huge leverage on power, and that wrecks democracy. So I think it's going to hurt our freedom. As far as security, I suppose if you want to have a totally secure state, you can have walls and everybody can be monitored 24 hours a day, and then you'd have very secure, you know, prisons are secure, and we can live in a prison if we want, but I don't think we should. I think that if people had the experience of living in, you know, a dictatorship, they would know that it's not a pretty, and that's what happens if you have total control over people, or, you know, partial control. I've lived in a dictatorship before, and it wasn't good.
I don't want to live in a world where everything that I say, everything I do, everyone I talk to, every expression of creativity or love or friendship is recorded. And that's not something I'm willing to support. It's not something I'm willing to build. And it's not something I'm willing to live under. So I think anyone who opposes that sort of world has an obligation to act in the way they can.